Hey everybody, welcome to this Xbox Life episode number 401, titled Another 100 in the Bank, because last week we completed episode 400. Nah, I'm just kidding. This is episode 400, another 100 in the bank. Can you believe it? We're 100 episodes in, and I am Rob, also known as Presar on Xbox Live. This is a solo show now because I have ditched the other two hosts because I'm tired of them talking about Destiny and Overwatch and that Barbie game that Mark always plays. So let's get on with the show. All right. Board game talk. I'm just kidding. Again, I can't stop. I can't stop today. So anyway, a couple of things that I did get right is that this is this Xbox Life, the show where we talk about Xbox and anything and everything about it, the games, the system, the community, and we have our own vibrant community as well. And joining me today on this monumental episode, as always, we have my good buddy, Mark.
Hey, everybody. How's it going?
There also known as
Wingman 709.
Wingman 709, the sweet, sultry sounds of Wingman. And then also on the other corner, we have Mr. Brun.
Hello, hello. BJ Swag 33, and I got my little sign here from my daughter that says 400 episodes on there.
So, nice.
My daughter is very excited. She's been telling me congratulations all day.
Yeah, how old was she when it started?
Let's see.
400 episodes ago.
400 episodes. We started in October of 2008.
Was it October? It seems like it was late summer.
Nope. I went back and looked.
Yeah.
It was like October 4th, 2008. So she would have been
just a youngin'.
2 o'clock. Or 2 o'clock. 2 years old.
2 o'clock.
Jeez. She'd have been two. Wow. So, and now she's 10.
She
they were still at the hospital with her. His wife was having a baby when we did our first episode.
Yeah.
That's how dedicated Bron was.
Yeah.
But wow. I will say, Bron, I don't care what your excuse is, that background is horrible.
Yeah, so
I'm not happy about that.
Yeah,
I just noticed it finally.
I knew you wouldn't have liked it too much, but the background is Braid, which was released August. Sorry, it was August, not October. We started in August. So it was August 6th, 2008 is when this game came out, and our first show was for this Xbox Life was August 4th, 2008.
Wait, August or October?
It was August.
Oh, August. Yes, August 4th.
Okay.
Yeah, I had to go back and look it up. I think that's what I bumped into a long time ago. It was 2008.
Yeah.
Many moons ago.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, because I remember my little buddy was he was just a couple months old.
Yeah.
And I was a lot more tired.
Yeah. You know, here
I was a lot more younger.
Yeah, here in the U.S., we're getting ready to put in a new president because our current president has gone through, you know, two terms, and 2008 was...
Too long?
No. Well, 2008 was his first year of his first term, so, you know, this Xbox Life has only seen one president.
No, wasn't the vote in 2008? So he would have started in January.
2009?
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Crazy.
See, I know this politics stuff, man.
It's a long time ago.
Oh, heck yeah.
So, Fancy Mouse wants us to do another 400.
Let's do it. You guys in?
Sure, I guess.
Ah, why not? I got nothing else to do.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
At that time, my daughter will be graduating high school. So, but
we'll be here rolling up in our wheelchairs.
You'll be a great grandfather.
Oh, no. Yeah, no, not now. Grandfather right now. It'll be a while before I'm a great grandfather. But thanks. Thanks anyways.
Episode 800. Or maybe by episode 1000. Or that time we'll have to evolve it beyond podcasts, whatever podcasts turn into.
Be the virtual podcast next with all the headsets. You know, you'll actually see us like sitting around a virtual table talking, sitting there with your headset on.
Yeah.
Like you're joined around the table. You'll look to your left and see Bron, look to your right and see Rob.
Man, that would have to be a big table to fit everybody as we're all wearing our PlayStation headgear.
Doing an Xbox show.
Yeah, you got to think. Yeah, I'll have some question for you guys, you know, before we end our show, obviously. About the future, what we think about the future of gaming and stuff. So, but cool.
Sure.
So, come on, Rob, don't drag us down.
Yeah, come on, Rob. Time to. They wanted to hear you talk more on episode 400. So keep on going.
Rock on. Ask and you shall receive. Do we want to do any more talking on episode 400, or we just want to get into it?
Oh, that's good. Get into it.
All right.
I think Wing's got a giveaway or something to do.
Yeah, right? Bron's waiting for. He's hoping for a short show.
I kind of expected this one not to be short.
Yeah, Wing was posting all these pictures today of this giveaway that he's having. He was showing the prize to everybody on the Facebook group.
I'm giving away an original Xbox.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I for some reason I thought it was something else.
It was white.
Anyway, so in case you haven't figured this out, if you're listening to this live, we record this show every Sunday at 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central, and I guess you can figure that out differently or however if you're in a different time zone. But so it's 10 p.m. Eastern. And why don't we start off by going into what we've been playing, which we normally do. And hey, since I'm doing the talking, I'll go first. I played some Tumblestones, and I think I mentioned it last week. It's actually a pretty decent game. Is it still free? Or was that last end of July?
Tomorrow's last day, or today, yeah. Or tomorrow's last day.
Yeah, if you haven't grabbed it, it's a pretty decent game. It was surprisingly better than I thought it was going to be. But it's basically a mobile style kind of like matching game like that you would expect to find on a phone. But it plays pretty well on the Xbox, and it has a pretty good local multiplayer. So I've been playing this with my son, where you can play up to four people locally, side by side. And it's pretty fun. And that's really about it. Been a very busy week for me otherwise. I keep looking at my game library. I don't know if you guys ever do this, but I keep looking at my game library, and I just have a hard time deciding on what to play. It's not for lack of anything being there. It just, I'm kind of like, you know, like I don't feel like playing anything. You guys know what I'm saying?
Yep.
Did you ever go through that?
I have for the past 2 weeks that you mentioned it, but I will say, like this weekend, I didn't have any problem finding something to play.
Nice.
So, yeah.
Not an issue this weekend, huh?
No, absolutely not.
So, yeah.
But,
yeah, and one thing I'm really stoked for, though, is I think we're, what, like 6 weeks away from Forza Horizon 3?
Yeah.
Coming soon.
Is that far out? Is that in September?
It's like September 27.
Oh, wow. That still seems like a long way away.
So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. 6 weeks and 2 days away. Yep. So I'm sure that my little summer doldrums of gaming will
September
be gone.
23rd.
Yeah.
23rd?
23rd.
Yeah. I haven't gotten to that countdown. Our first
So it's
countdown.
Coming out on a Friday?
Is it a Friday?
It says the 23rd, according to the...
Hey, I'm fine with that. That's
page,
4 days
the page
early.
We always use.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean this is right.
Yeah.
I think that's right, because XCOM 2 comes out on the 27th, and I know Forza was listed coming out before that.
So. Yeah.
At that point, they should just have it come out on the 20th. If they want to stick to normal Tuesdays.
Here in our household, our first countdown is the countdown for school starting. That's our first countdown, which I think's like, yes, we got one more week until school starts, and then the next countdown is the start of our would be the youngest of my step boys, his senior year in football. So that's when football season starts up. They had a scrimmage this weekend or this Friday. So finally got to watch some football again, and that's really exciting. So then I'll worry about games.
It's coming Whatever. Up. You know you're waiting for September 6th, Bron. Just admit it. When Just Sing comes out.
What is it? Just Sing. Yes, I'm very excited about that. I'm going to duel it out with my daughter, who will beat me. She's a very good singer.
All right. So
let me just say, I want to say real quick to interject here, totally off topic. I want to say thanks to Horrible Gamers, because those guys have been tweeting out to their community, telling everybody about our 400th show. There's a couple of the guys in here in our Twitch feed congratulating us. So thanks. I mean, that's just cool that these guys are, you know, talking up another show to their community. So we really appreciate that. That was really cool, you guys.
Yep.
So, and I look forward to your 400th show as well.
Yeah, we got a number of things, you know. See, like Juan and Gunny, and I see John Matthews was retweeting, Jason Jackson was retweeting. Yeah, like I had more blowing up Twitter retweets and comments, and a lot of it was spawned off a Horrible Gamers tweet of, you know, congratulating us on 400, and everybody was kind of retweeting off that. It was actually fun last couple days reading. Seeing that come through,
yeah,
it was pretty neat. So, yeah, but
oh, cool. Heck yeah!
All right, who's next?
All right, that's you, Brun.
Oh, me? Okay, yeah. So things that were not hard for me to play this weekend was Overwatch on my PC and Overwatch on my Xbox One. So, very, very fun. I haven't really gotten into, like I said before on previous shows, I haven't really gotten into it on the Xbox One because I couldn't really find people to play. And somebody mentioned it to play it for FNL, and here we are 2 days later of nonstop Overwatch play on Xbox One. I think I went from like 15, I think I'm 22, 21 or 22 on Xbox, and I even came and played a little bit on the PC as well, and I think I'm 39 there. So, you know, it's been fun. It's nice to get, last night it was like 1 in the morning, or 12 or 1 in the morning, and it was like Xbox record that and a couple of his friends and a couple of people from the community. And there were six of us, you know, Wing was there. There were six of us in the room, and we were winning or whatever. And then a couple of people dropped out. Very end of the night, we got stuck with a group who were all, I think every single one of them were over 100. So they all had the bronze stars underneath them. And one guy had two bronze stars underneath, and he was like level 72. So he was 272, and we're like playing, and we're like, what is going on? Like, they brought in like three Reapers, and it was crazy. And we're like, what is going on? And then we saw who we were playing. We're like, oh, okay, we don't. Somebody's like, I don't feel as bad now, you know? And they're like, do we want
to punch the ejection handle, right? I'm out.
Well, that's the thing. It's like, do we want to back out? And somebody's like, no, let's play. It's like, we know what we're playing against now. Let's go in there and play. And we beat them the next round. We beat them the next game.
Wow.
And then the next game after that, they beat us. And then the next game after that, we beat them. So it ended up being 2-2. But it was just like, you know, we felt pretty good about ourselves after that, beating a group like that. And I'll tell you what.
A beating or a beat down?
Oh, well, it was both. It was a combination of both. It was nice playing against people that are just that hard, because you've really felt like the five of us that were there were working more as a team. And that's what happens in that game. When you get a team together that can just play, it's just like, it's craziness. So, and I will say, like, that night, or, you know, those couple rounds and last night playing on the Xbox is by far the best time I had playing Overwatch, you know. And I've stated before, I've played more on PC, but I've had so much fun. And those are probably rank up there with like the second or third best, you know, best rounds that I've ever played. You know, played in that game, because I did have a 3-round competitive match with a competitive group. And what happened there was we would get to 99%. They would take the point. They would get it to 99. And I think one time we had a 10-minute overtime.
Whoa.
So, and we did that two out of the three rounds, I think it was. And the other one was like 5 or 6 minutes. Like overall, the entire competitive match almost lasted 40 minutes. So it was insane. And we lost. The other team beat us. But when we were done, it was like, you know, the teams were talking back and forth like, this is by far the best game or match I've ever watched, I've ever played in my life. And it was nuts. So, but yeah, I had a lot of fun. And I really want to do Overwatch again for FNL if people are up to it. If I'm back in time. So it might have to be a later FNL for me because of football. So, but that's what I played. Overwatch and Overwatch. So, Mark?
All right. I played Just Cause 3 this week. The final DLC came out. It came out for preview members. I think it comes our season pass members. So I think it's out for everyone else this coming week. But yeah, I played through the last DLC of that. Had a lot of fun. Played some Battleship, which is the Hasbro Family Game Night part or Family Game Channel, whatever it is. The Hasbro Game Channel, I think we called it. That's a new release for that, so I played a little bit of that. Also played some Overwatch, joined you last night, Brun. And I got to say, that was the most fun on Overwatch I've ever had, was last night with everybody. Even when we lost, we had some just so close matches, and it was just fun. I liked, you know, playing as Mercy and just trying to keep everyone healed. And I know that helps out a lot. And it's just, you know, you don't get points for killing anybody, but, you know, it's fun to go and make sure we keep the team alive. I enjoyed that. But my favorite, this was by far the coolest, was our match. We were playing on the Hollywood map, and I played as Bastion, and we were defending, and I got on that, by the car, I got on the little elevator that just goes up and down, and I just transformed into the turret, and I just sat there, and, well, no, not at first. At first, we all met them at the door, and five Reinhardts came out, so I kind of ran around the corner to get behind them, and a couple other guys worked their way behind them, and we just annihilated them, and then I went back, and I got on that elevator, and I just sat there as the turret. Sat there the entire game.
Yeah.
Continued to wipe them out. I went 23-0. I've never had that happen in a game, especially of Overwatch. Twice, two Reinhardts. I don't know if it was the same guy or different people. I don't really remember. But two Reinhardts came up trying to get me off of there, and I was able to kill them. And then they had their Genji try to take me out, and he got on the platform as well, and I was somehow survived and took him out as well. And it was great. It was just, they never took that point, and I just stayed in the same spot. I don't know. I couldn't figure out, well, a lot of them, they just stayed as Reinhardt, and I think that's what just killed them, because they were just standing there with their shields, but I'm like taking their shields down, and you know, there was no really offense from them. So it was really strange. I'm not sure what they were trying to accomplish, but they got their butt handed to them. And I think there was someone else on our team who went, what did he go, 26-0?
Yeah.
25-0. So he was, yeah, it was insane. I mean, but that was so much fun. But it was just overall, it was a really good time. But with all that being said, today I played a little game of Switcheroo. And I said, I was getting rid of my Xbox. I said, I was tired of it. I was fed up, and it's gone, man. I think it kicked that thing to the curb. That baby has been replaced. Look at that. Woo! Trying to make sure I can get that in the.
Yeah.
Get that in frame.
We all see it.
So my Xbox One S showed up today, and it is now sitting in my office. My Xbox One has been demoted to the family room, which makes my kids extremely happy.
Oh, they were
so excited.
Did the Wii go out the window?
The Wii and the 360 are still all plugged into that TV out there.
Yeah.
So they don't ever play the Wii, but I don't know. They still got to keep it hooked up in case the moment ever strikes them. But so yeah, I plugged the S in and got it hooked up and got it all set up, and It's pretty cool. I'm enjoying it. I will say this, and I did post a couple pictures on Facebook, just one or two, not 300 like Rob was claiming. But I posted a few up there just kind of show size comparison. Everybody's seen these and stuff. So
yeah.
But
no, but, I mean it's nice to see that stuff from somebody that you know versus, you know, professional staged pictures. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah, I think it. That's how I feel, because then you kind of like, okay, I believe this picture. The one thing on mine that I thought of afterwards was that I with my Xbox One, the S does look a lot smaller when I'm sitting it on top of my Xbox One, because I actually have an additional hard drive attached on the left side.
Yeah, you have one of those.
It gives me the USB ports. So my Xbox One was actually bigger than the standard, not by much. But it adds probably, an inch to the width. So actually, the overall picture is a little deceiving in that way, because I forgot that I had that on there when I took the picture. I'm just so used to it being there. And I remember I looked at it afterwards and I was like, oh, wait a minute. This isn't really a true reflection of the Xbox One, because I've got this additional piece on the side and I was sitting over that. But still, it's when the box showed up, I was like, when the box came in from Amazon, I was like, and then the postal worker handed it to me, I was like, man, this thing's light. And I'm like, this must be something else. Maybe they sent me the wrong thing because the box was too small. Well, I was hugging the box.
Oh,
I thought I ran out there my bare feet. I saw the mail truck pull in, and my wife and her dad were standing out there, and I ran out of the house in my bare feet. I know what this is. And she's like, no, I don't think that's it. And I was like, no, I know what it is. But anyways, the box, I thought, like, this looks awful small. This looks smaller than I expected it to be. And no, it's in here. It was in the box. And then I was like, okay, well, this box is pretty large. And then when I opened it up, I was really surprised how small this thing is. It is smaller than I expected it to be. And I know they said, and I've seen the videos, and even the pictures I post doesn't really make it look that small, but it is. It's like when you see one, you're like, wow. It is slimmer. It doesn't sit as tall. It's skinnier. It's in every way, it is smaller. And it's really nice looking. I haven't had a whole lot of time to play with it, but I did set it up, and of course I had to do an install the most current OS. So I updated that. But what was really neat, what it was really cool about this that I like, was when it first comes on, and it shows your controller and it says hit the Xbox button, right? You hit that, and then it says hit A. It shows you, hit A. And I hit A, and it immediately synced. I didn't have to do the sync buttons. There's no synchronizing, like hit it on the console and hit it on your thing. On these new controllers, they somehow when you turn them on, I don't know, well, at least with this one out of the box, it synced right away. And then it went through its update of the console, and then it came up. When that was done, it said there's a controller update. And it says, hit A to update. And I'm thinking, well, wait, don't I have to plug a cord in? So I just hit A.
No.
And no, it updates wirelessly updates the controller now. Well, which I'm like, that is awesome.
Through Bluetooth. So that's the benefits you get on the Bluetooth and not just wireless connectivity.
Right.
Now, so, when you update the controller, does it still have you put it down and not move it?
Well, I hit the button and it started. And that's when I read, don't move the controller. So I was sitting as still as I could. My daughter was in there and she was kind of bouncing around. I'm like, don't hit my chair. She's like, huh? I'm like, don't hit my chair. I'm trying not to move. Okay. So, but I can always resync it again if I have to. Yeah. But yeah, I always set them down. So yeah, set it down and then hit the A button.
Okay.
Just so it doesn't, because it will, if you do move it when it's doing that, it can throw off the, the sync or the, something with it. I've had it before where I was moving it and it was like way off. It didn't work right. I had to resync it or re-update it and then it worked fine. So, but no, it was working today. I didn't really put it through any paces. It seemed fine afterwards. So but that was just a nice feature of it. My Kinect won't plug in yet. So I did reach out to Microsoft support and they're shipping me my adapter already.
That's a free adapter. Right.
It's free for a limited time. So just keep that in mind. If you wait to get this for a year from now, you probably won't get the free adapter update. So But well, yeah,
it's going to be debatable if it's even going to matter.
It probably won't. I'm getting it, and I'm thinking, well, I kind of want an Xbox One Kinect out front. Well, I'm like, well, I got a 360 Kinect. I wonder if it will work. I plugged it in. It doesn't work on the Xbox One. And then when I went to the adapter page, it says your 360 will not work on the Xbox One. So,
yeah, okay. Different.
So,
I knew they were different, but I'm like, well, let me try it.
Yeah.
Because it's USB. Because I have an adapter on that one to go to a USB. Because I've got the original Kinect. Like, my Kinect for my 360 was, I was in the beta program. They sent me one before they were released.
Oh, yeah.
Remember? So I got my Kinect for free.
That's right.
So I've got like the real old school original Kinect, but it didn't work. So I might pick one up just so I got one out there right now, because I had to unplug the Chromecast to plug in the Xbox One, and I'm like, I don't really want to feed the TV through it, because then it, you know, if I get it so where I can have a Kinect on it, then and the kids can just walk in and tell it to turn on. And then I can have the Kinect turn everything on. Then yeah, it'll work great. I'll just run the TV through. So, but the one, I don't know. I may never do that, because I did find out today that when I turn on my S, then it logs me out on the other one in the other room. I was like, well, that would suck if I'm playing a game and all of a sudden the kids go turn the TV on in the other room and I'm logged out. No.
Yeah, you want to make sure you're not set up as the default login on the other one.
Well, I am on the other one too. Yeah. So. But they're so I'll have to get them some local accounts and have them log into those. But it's nice. I'm really excited about when I travel, because I used to have to carry the big Xbox and an external hard drive and this brick. Power brick.
That was my favorite picture, by the way.
Oh yes, I couldn't believe it. This is tiny little cable. I'm like, this is my power cord. So I set it on top of the Xbox One S. And then I put the power brick on top so you could see the comparison of those two. So, but it's going to be nice when I travel. In with a 2 gig internal drive or 2 terabyte internal drive, I can take whatever. So my external drive, I kept that and plugged it in. So everything was there. I didn't have to re-download any games or anything. And I made the external my default for installs. And then, so if now when I travel, if I'm like, okay, I want to play this game, say I'm like when The Division came out, I was actually on the road, and I played the crud out of that the whole week. So it's like, that's all I need to do. But now I can just say, okay, move it to the internal, put a couple games on the internal, and walk away. I don't need to carry the external drive. I don't need to carry the external drive's power pack. I don't need to carry the big power brick anymore. It's one box and with a regular cord and a controller, and that's it. It's like, oh, it's going to make life so much better. And it's so much lighter.
That's one big thing I'm hoping with the Scorpio when it comes out, is that the internal hard drive is like a 4 or 6 terabyte hard drive. Small terabytes. Yeah. I mean, I understand why they're doing it, you know, saves money and everything. Or make it to where we can put our own drives in. And it's not, an external hard drive is not a burden to me. Like, I don't care. That's what I have as well. Like, you don't even see mine. Mine's back behind the TV. Right. So it doesn't really bother me that it's there. And I like it to where if I have to reset my Xbox, like, I just have to unplug it and plug it back in. Everything's good to go.
Yep.
But it is for like moving it and stuff like that, which is probably rare for me, but not as much for you, but just to have everything in that one box. But yeah, you're right. Just move some, you know, things over and stuff like that. But yeah, my favorite picture was that one of the power cord. I thought that was pretty funny. So
I can't remember if I put that one on the Facebook group or not. I think I just sent that to you guys.
Yeah, that was funny. You should put it up there because it's pretty funny.
All right.
You know, and one more thing about the S. I know we were talking about not saying anything, but I feel really guilty. Was that we had a whole plan that we were going to give away that Xbox One. And you decided to keep it for yourself. And we even drew a winner, like Dark Christoph. Christoph is actually the winner of it. And you're just like, no. You're
such a liar.
No, Christoph just lives too close, you know. I'm just kidding with everybody.
You're such a liar.
Christoph's in here. He said, did you talk about our epic game against the multi-prestige team last night? And I said, yeah, and he was late. So I figured I'd just pull a trick on him. So, yes, Dark Christoph was the winner of the free Xbox One S, but Wing took it.
Yeah, right.
Ganked it.
I had to go get approval. This was out of my own personal bank, not the TXL bank.
Oh, yeah.
I had to get approval from my wife. And the funny thing is she already said, she already knows that I want Scorpio next year. So she even said, well, yeah, because she made a comment to her dad, well, today about, well, yeah, and he's just going to want another one next year. He's already told me that.
Well, she probably doesn't know about the 4K TV yet.
She does not. So we'll work that one in somewhere. But I was asked if I had a 4K TV. I do not. I don't have that yet. And I'm really, the main reason I got this S was strictly mainly just for when I travel. I just wanted something smaller and easier to travel with. This will make life a lot easier for that.
So it was a business purchase?
Yeah, it was a sole business purchase.
Nice.
Man. Yeah, no, it didn't.
But no, and it's just, you know, and it gave me the opportunity to take the other one, the Xbox One, out into the family room where we didn't have a Blu-ray player. So now we do. It also gives me the ability to stream stuff, you know, as well, using like the HBO Go. That, you know, we can now have that out there. Of course, the kids use it. We use a 360, but the 360 is so slow. Man, it takes forever to boot that thing up. So having the Xbox One just to instant on and be able to play something is so much nicer. So, and it gives them a newer console that I might let them play games on. Just as long as they don't log me out. So, no, I don't have the TV yet. That will probably come along with the Scorpio somehow. I got to work that one out. So
who was it one time where they're just like, You don't ask for permission. You just buy it and then ask for forgiveness.
It's easier to ask for forgiveness than it is for permission.
Yes. As I look to my right at my wife sitting in the other room. And yeah, I don't think she's too keen on that saying.
Yeah. No, I went and asked my wife. I was smart. Can I please get this?
Yeah.
And I was surprised. I really thought she'd say no. And she's like, kind of gave me this look, and she's like, what is it, $500? I'm like, no.
With an eye roll.
No. Oh, what, $400? I'm like, no, not even that.
$399.
I'm sitting there going, but it is $400. No, no, it's not.
No, is there a four at the start? No, that's a three.
Yes.
And free shipping.
Dollar range. That's why you got to say it's in the $300 range.
Nice.
$399 is still in the $300s.
That is true.
Did you tell her how you got a deal and you got free 2-day shipping?
Yeah. Well, I did mention I'll get it shipped for free. I did say that. It was, she knows that because we buy everything through Amazon. So, but no, she's like, yeah, go ahead. So I was like, awesome. You're the greatest.
Yeah.
It's not just an Xbox. It comes with a controller too.
Yeah, true.
So am I going to get a Scorpio as well or stay with the S? I am planning to get a Scorpio. So the S will probably migrate. Well,
to
since
my house.
Brad said we got to give this one away, I guess we'll give it away next year. No, we're keeping this. This is mine. This was not a TXL purchase. I'll keep it. We'll find a home for it, or it'll just be my travel one. It'll just sit there and sit in my suitcase. So, because I expect the Scorpio to be larger, I really do. I think it's going to be more on par with the original Xbox. Or the Xbox One, I would expect it to be larger. So, and being that a premium of what that's probably going to be, I probably won't want to lug it around, but we'll see. But enough of that.
Hey, actually, before we move on, I had one last question about the Xbox One S.
Yes.
And I don't know if this is too early for you to answer this, but seeing that they built the power brick essentially into the unit, so previously, with Xbox One original, they had this big power brick that made the unit smaller, even though it was as big as it was. You know, the power supply was not in the unit, it was external, which made the box a little smaller. Now, with it being built into the Xbox One S, would you have preferred to have a separate power brick and have the case be smaller yet?
No. I like it built in. I really do.
Okay.
because it's just one box that I can put in a suitcase with a small power cord, you know, that right. sits there instead of a box and a brick. So I prefer it the way it is. I think it's great. Now, is it too hot or whatnot? I don't know. I mean, it's only been installed this afternoon. So, and it's been off actually most of the day because once I got it up and running, we went to watch a movie with the kids in the other room. So, I don't think there's going to be an issue. I think they've tested these things out enough that I don't think we'll, someone mentioned Red Ring, but you know, if you think about the Red Ring, I think the original 360s had a power brick too. Right. So it doesn't. That was a whole different thing that had nothing to do with the power in there. So I think we're in good shape, and I actually really like it. I'm really surprised, even though it's white. But the cool thing is you know, I got a white controller. Well, my custom controller that I ordered is also white. You know, originally I was like, well, I don't want a white one, but I came up with this white blue design that I really liked. Well, now it's gonna match. So
nice.
I thought of that today because my daughter's like, oh, is that your new controller? It's like, no, it's not here yet. So my kids got me that for Father's Day and it still hasn't gotten here. So they're like, what's up with that?
Yeah.
Like, well, it's custom. It's a one of a kind. They got to make it and goes in line of when they were ordered. And so I'm still not expecting. I think they said September is when it will get here. So I still sometime next month.
Right. But.
Cool. And no, I haven't noticed any difference. Someone asked if I noticed a difference. No, as for gameplay, I haven't seen anything. And I don't think I'm going to see anything because I don't have a 4K TV. I don't have HDR. Until I get those, I'm not going to see really a difference. Supposedly, games like Gears of War 4 do run better on the S, but that game's not out yet. So, I didn't get it for that. I didn't get it for the 4K and the, it's just, mainly just, I wanted the smaller one. And, some of the issues I've had with the other one kind of also helps, like, okay, let's get a new one. Let's get a refresh of the hardware. Let's see how it goes. So, and I love my Xbox. So I'm not leaving the Xbox brand anytime soon.
All right. Rub.
So, Mark, I forgot. Did you talk about what you were playing? I think you did, right?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. That was so long ago. Before we went off on our wonderful little informative tangent.
Yeah.
All right. So if there's something that you benefit from the show, if you enjoy the show and you want to think about it, like, how can I do a favor to this Xbox Life? For everything that they have done for me over the past 400 episodes. Well, here's an idea for you. You can support us on Patreon. You can go to patreon.com/thisxboxlife and it's like a pledge, I think is what they call it, or something like that, whatever they call it. You can patronize us and do whatever amount you feel that is good for you. And we definitely appreciate that. Helps us defray some of the costs of running the show because we have actually since day one pretty much done this out of pocket. So anything that you can do to show your thanks would be greatly appreciated. Also, you can leave us a tip on Twitch Alerts. That's twitchalerts.com/donate/thisxboxlife. And all of these links you can also find on our webpage at thisxboxlife.com. And now let's roll into the topics for this week, episode 400. First off, there's a little bit of a hoopla that happened with the Battlefield Collector's Edition earlier this week.
Money
I think was a little bit, there's a little instigation by IGN.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That was kind of bogus. When you guys wanted to starts off.
Oh, I will. Yeah, yeah.
Because, been chomping at the bit for this.
Yeah.
Well, it's funny because we talked about it on the show, and we even, you know, I was just like, you know, let's see if we can, you know, because it's almost like they don't investigate. You know, news journalism, they don't investigate. They just do clickbait, you know, links and this and that. We talked about it on the previous show, And then, you know, Mark put it in Facebook, and I looked at it, I'm like, what? And then I clicked on it, and I read the article, which was titled in a way to make you click on it. And then not to the very end of the article does the guy actually, the person that actually wrote it, explain what is going on. So the thing is for the people that don't read the full article, they don't realize what's going on. And all of a sudden they just blow up. And like you read the chat and the comments and you can tell the first 3,000 people that read it didn't read the whole article. You know, yeah. Because what it was Amazon is selling the Battlefield 1 Collector's Edition for $130 without the game. Okay. So if you look on Amazon, there's three collector's editions for Battlefield 1. There's a $170 version. Wait, hold on. I think that's what it is. It's it's either $200, $190, or $130 or something like that. Sure. I'd have to look it up. The $200 comes with the game and the it comes with the collector's edition stuff, the statue and all that stuff. And the game that you get is the $70 version of Battlefield 1, which comes...
Is that retail?
I think it's
copy of disc?
It's the disc.
Okay.
Okay. And I'm going to go out to Amazon right now and I'm going to look it up because I don't want to be like IGN. collector's edition. All right. So there's a $209 version, which is the Battlefield exclusive collector's edition deluxe. So you're getting the collector's edition. You're getting the deluxe version of the game, right? Which is what the deluxe version I would buy, but I buy digital. For $189 is the collector's edition and the regular version of the game, disc base. Okay.
Sure.
And then there's the $129 version, which is just the collector's edition. Just the collector stuff. And that edition, minus the game, minus the extra $60, is for all the wonderful people out there, like myself, who buy the game digital, but want all the collector statue and stuff, so you don't have to buy the game twice. Thank you, EA, for listening and not screwing up like you did last time. You're not as money hungry as everybody in the comments likes to think you are. So no, that's the whole purpose of that version. If you guys remember Battlefield, or no, it was Halo. Maybe it was Halo that was really confusing, where the most expensive version came with digital and didn't come with disc, and people were mad because they wanted the disc and not
Halo.
The you know, not this, not that. Well, what Battlefield did was, you want the disc, you buy the, and you want the collector's edition, you either buy it with the deluxe disc, the regular disc, or for all you wonderful people that want to buy the regular or deluxe on digital, but you want all the stuff, here's a version for you. We took the dollars off. You know, you're still end up paying the same amount of money that you would, but you get your digital copy. That is awesome. Wonderful. Thank you. And that is what that is all about. And Mark and I was playing the top five news articles from IGN, and it was Naomi Kyle, and she went over this article and says, so if you want to pay $130 and something, something, and not get the game, and you want a wonderful statue without the game, and blah, 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 blah. And they never explained in that entire news segment what it was really for. So when it comes down to, you know, and here's the thing is, I've always considered game media, I've always considered it journalism, right? Because there's always this fight of, is games media journalism? And I think when they put the effort into looking up news stories and fact checking and do all this, they're journalists, right? They get to do that. I have now changed my mind. No, it's not journalism. It is just happy clickbait. Let's write some articles. So, and I don't really comment on IGN hardly at all. And I finally had to put a comment because somebody said, I feel like this link is just clickbait, and I fell for it. And I had to respond to him like, yes, this is clickbait, and this is a person manipulating and basically trying to, you know, force their readers down the wrong road and give them wrong impressions and do this. And I said, I almost put in my comment as like, the person didn't even research and give you the correct information. But I read through the whole article and it's all the way at the very bottom. I said, what I've learned from this article is that you cannot trust this person, whatever his name was. I don't even remember, not to trust any of his articles and just don't bother reading them, because he just misleads all your readers. I was like, there's just no reason to read any of his articles anymore. It's pathetic. So, but yeah, that's what that was. And it's really not because it's Battlefield why I'm defending it. The thing that bothers me the most is because we just talked about it on our last episode. We just talked about this stuff happening, and they turn around, they do it again, and you just read the comments, and it was just like, this is why EA is the worst company, you know, year after year after year. And then you finally start to see, like, you know, four or five replies deep is like, did you even read the article? You do realize this is for people who want the digital version of the game, so you don't have to buy the game twice. And then it's just like, oh, yeah. Oh, sorry. You know, except they don't apologize on, you know, the internet, because your opinion is the only one that matters and is always right. But yes, that is what's going on. So don't get all bent out of shape, everybody. Whoever is going to buy the collector's edition of Battlefield 1, you can buy it without the game if you're going to buy digital. So,
yeah.
Congratulations. So, yeah, that one's that one.
Yeah, and we can definitely see what game journalism, at least web journalism, has, if that is such a thing. What it's devolved to.
Yeah.
I could just see these guys in their meetings every morning. It's like, okay, guys, Fred, you need an article by end of day to generate more clicks. Doesn't matter what it is. Mm-hmm. Go get it.
Well, it's funny. Oh. Do you guys watch John Oliver on HBO?
No.
Okay. John Oliver is a very funny guy, you know, and, you know, he doesn't really stick to, like, he goes with the jokes and rolls with the punches, you know, and with most mainstream media, as we found out, you know, lean certain way politically here in the U.S. And to him, I really can't tell what he is. But to me, I don't care. I don't care what he is. He's a funny guy. And every episode, it's every Sunday, he targets like a 20-minute segment about something that's really it's really important. And they really dive into it. And they really are journalists, you know, and doing journalism and stuff. And it is about journalism and print, right? Because print journalism's dying. But if you guys ever watch the news, you'll always notice that a news station will say, according to, and they'll rattle off a paper. According to, and they'll rattle off a paper. You know, like New York Times and this and that, like where all the real journalists are. And they kind of go over that, and they went into, like, media and with print dying, like that's what they have to do. They're like, oh, we need you to post this much on social media. We need you to, you know, write this many articles. You're responsible now for not only writing the articles, but for doing the video and the pictures. And, you know, you have to tweet 5,000 times a day. And that's essentially, Rob, what you're saying jokingly is exactly what it's like. I imagine IGN's meetings with how they figure out how they're going to clickbait everybody. It is like watching a TMZ, you know, meeting. You know, I think don't they have a TV show, or TMZ have a TV show where they just talk about how they're going to stalk like famous people and ruin their lives with stupid things and, you know, go through their Twitter accounts or something. So that's what I feel like IGN when it comes to media does. And it's sad to say that, because they're my go-to source for game media or for gaming news, but it's just like, it's embarrassing. It's really a downfall. So,
oh yeah, but I mean, it's almost like they're switching from a trusted news source to more like a tabloid.
Yeah, that's what they are.
And yep. I mean, that's disappointing.
Yep. So, yeah.
So, all right, moving on. We had some very positive.
Real quick, I just wanted to say that I do expect Rob. That when you post the show this week on our website, that you will say something to the fact of, Mark rips out his Xbox One and you won't believe what happens next.
Yeah. It's like the news station.
Ron, you need to do that on all our social media sites. Come on.
Yeah, it's
what we have to do, right?
Yeah.
I got one. I got one. All right. I'll put something along the lines of Mark pulled it out and Rob and Brun's jaws dropped.
Oh boy. Okay.
The Xbox One S.
You know, I always go back to that joke, you know, like it's 5 p.m., you know, you yourself or your wife or whatever is getting ready to cook dinner, and you hear on the 5 o'clock news, like, is what you're cooking for dinner going to kill you and your children?
Yeah.
News at 11. And you're like,
yes. After you weren't eating it. Yeah.
News at 11. So, but yeah.
All right.
Yes.
So what's next?
All right. So we had some very promising news back in actually recently from something that happened in July. And that's the unthinkable in the last 2 years being that the Xbox One outsold the PlayStation. I think for like the first time in 2 years, isn't it? Almost three.
It's been a while. It hasn't been three. They outsold them last year.
It was right around Christmas.
Yeah, around Christmas they outsold them. So,
So it happened accidentally twice now.
Yeah. Yeah, which is weird. I mean, because I remember the 360 going on like a 36-month streak of outselling the, you know, so they've yet to break Xbox's record on that part, but. Yeah, I saw that and I put it in, it was in Facebook somewhere in our Facebook group. I'm like, holy cow. I'm like, wow. It's like, you know, but that's nothing like 40 million. And then somebody said, I heard on a podcast last week, somebody saying that Sony bought a bunch and, you know, bought 19 million of their own consoles and they're storing them in a warehouse somewhere.
heard that same story.
I know. That's crazy.
It must be true. I heard it on the internet.
Yes. And the only reason why Xbox probably outsold them in July is probably because their warehouse was full. You know, so they didn't have any more room to buy anymore. So,
that's right.
That's what I've heard, guys. You should spread that.
Oh, what they're doing is they'll buy them and then they just restock them and they buy them again. So they're just buying the same one, like.
Cycle them.
So really, they've only sold like 8 million.
Yeah.
They just keep buying the same 8 million over and over.
So what you're saying is that their factory isn't able to produce enough of them. So to meet orders, they're buying the ones that they made previously.
There you go.
To resupply the chain.
Yeah.
Exactly.
You heard it here first, folks.
You heard it here first. Well, the one thing that really cracks me up is even on the Xbox side, because we're over 20 million, I think, now. And then, you know, the PlayStation's over 40 million. It's just when the big game comes out, like, oh my gosh, you know, Gears of War 4, or like when Gears of War 4 releases, and it's like, oh, they sold 8 million. It's like, but you have 20 million consoles out there. Like, this is an exclusive. Like, I know not everybody's a first-person shooter or anything. But, you know, when No Man's Sky. Like, I can't wait to see the numbers for No Man's Sky because, you know, that was supposed to be a console exclusive to PlayStation. They have 40 million. It was supposed to be this huge thing that everybody's waiting for. And it's going to come out and it's like, oh, they sold 6 million. It's like, you only sell 6 million? Or, you know, like, I'm just making that number up. But let's say it was 6 million. It's like, you have 40-plus million consoles out there, and all you sell is 6 million of this game that is you guys have been waiting for 5 years to come out. And it goes both ways. It's Xbox and, you know, Halo 4 or Halo 5 comes out.
I don't think that's exclusive either, Ron.
What's that?
I think we're going to find out No Man's Sky is coming to Xbox.
Oh, really? Somebody mentioned it, right?
I'm trying to remember where I read this. Somebody had asked one of the developers or whatnot at some recent event, if it's coming to Xbox One. And they're like, well, I cannot answer that question. It wasn't like, I can't answer. It was like, you know, I'm more of like, I'm not allowed to answer that question. And then I guess there was some Sony PR guy who jumped in and got them like, change the subject. It was some guy from Sony, because I don't know if it was a Sony event or I'm sorry, I don't have the specifics. But I found that interesting that the people that made No Man's Sky are like, we're not allowed to actually answer that question. And I've heard other people saying, well, Sony possibly will buy this developer if it sells really well. You know, they might want to try to keep it. And that's probably why. So I think they may have a version or they were developing it for both and Sony gave them so much money. But what I don't understand about this is it seems to me that several years ago, this was the same company that was like they were like in a basement of a building or something and it flooded or caught fire or something. And Microsoft actually financially bailed them out.
And that's why I was surprised
this game didn't get to our console here.
Yeah. I think it was both of them.
Wasn't this the game that was done by like four people or something?
It's like 15, 14.
Okay. No.
But less than 20.
This is huge. I think it's going to sell big regardless because, I mean, I'm curious to see it too, but I do think it's going to be a success on Sony. Yeah. Jesus Walks a Lot went and bought a PS4 just for this game.
Yeah, no, I want to pick it up on PC. Like, I definitely want to play it. But I have your article here, Wing. It says, "Hello Games, Sean Murray vaguely responds to a question about whether or not No Man's Sky could come to Xbox One, leading to speculation of the game's arrival to the console."
Yeah.
So it looked like it was speaking with the UK press outlet Daily Star.
Maybe it'll be a Gamescom news
could
thing.
Be. That's this week.
It could be. And we have a question later on in our thing that maybe this would fit in there. So, but we'll talk about when we get there.
And Jesus says, "I did do that." So Jesus, how bad are you going to feel when No Man's Sky is announced this week for Xbox One?
Yeah.
He'll be fine. Hey, he gets to play on two consoles. So, and we don't hate Sony. There's no, you know, it's fun ribbing when we do it, just so everybody knows. There's any new listeners. We don't hate Sony. We gotta have a friendly jab at them every once in a while, but we're all gamers and we don't care what platform you're on. Just get along and have fun.
Yeah.
Okay, so moving along. So,
yeah, going back to the numbers, they kind of Microsoft released that total gaming hours on Xbox consoles was up 18% over last year, reaching 1.55 billion hours. That's crazy. Yeah, 1.5 billion hours. Man. And that's about it. That's the main stuff there. Although, do you think that those numbers where it was a best-selling console, does that include pre-orders for the Xbox One S? Or is it just sales of the old ones?
Well,
when did the
if you I guess it depends because like Amazon, you don't get billed until they ship it. So if you pre-ordered it in July, it wouldn't count until they shipped it. And that thing came out in August, right? It was just like a week, 2 weeks ago, August 2nd, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I don't think the S would be included because they hadn't shipped out yet in July. So Microsoft might see another win in August if they truly sold out. Now, I don't buy the article saying the Xbox One S sold out because I just ordered mine on Friday.
Yeah, I saw where people were saying that you can get them. They're still on Amazon. I think
Amazon still got them. I got mine and it was here 2 days later. So
there's a limited run. I mean, basically what it is there's a limited run of the 2 gig version and then they're kicking down to the terabyte and the 500 gig version. And then what
they mean is Microsoft is they've made all they're making and all of them have been bought out by retailers.
Right.
And so what Microsoft is going to make now are the 1 gig and the 500 gigs because they want the cheaper options.
Yeah.
Because that's, I mean, as much as like Braun and, you know, and Rob and I, we all want the larger hard drives. The problem is when it comes first party, there's a bigger price tag. And that bigger price tag, I mean, Sony is winning. I mean, honestly, the whole the P thing, you know, the 1080p versus the 970p or whatever. Oh, that's not the reason Xbox One is losing. Xbox One is losing because they put $100 Kinect in the package out the door, and Sony said, we're not going to do that, and they were $100 cheaper.
Yeah, yeah.
Basically the same console. So that's why everybody went that way. That's why everybody's going that way. Yeah. The S, they got to get the cheaper ones out to be the $299 because now you've got, okay, now you look at it what the PS4 is. If they're at the same price, you can go, well, I can get an Xbox One S that supports HDR, 4K video, and it's an Ultra HD Blu-ray. You know? So yep. We don't know what Neo is going to have. At this point, I don't know if the Neo is going to come out to compete with the S, or are they going to, or is that getting pushed back to compete with Scorpio? I mean, we really don't know.
Oh.
But if it comes out this year and they throw in an Ultra HD drive, then they might be able to compete. But then are they going to have anything to compete against Scorpio next year?
Well, I mean, the Neo won't be out to compete with the Scorpio. The Neo is going to come out to
for
VR and stuff like that. Like, the Neo wasn't to compete with anything. You know, like, we had no idea really about the S. We had an idea about the Scorpio. But if you guys remember, you know, the Neo wasn't being shown at E3 or anything. And I'm not going to say that.
I still think it got dropped because of the Scorpio announcement.
Well, I'm not going to
believe it got pulled.
I mean, if you remember, I'm not going to say I told you so or anything if it does come out to happen, because I wouldn't do that when I made the comment that the Scorpio literally scared Sony into pulling the Neo because it would be a big mistake on their part. And, you know, we would never think that the Neo would come out with different increased specs and then all of a sudden be pushed out to compete with the Scorpio, because that Sony would not do that. You know, they don't need to do that because they're number one. But I wouldn't say I told you so or anything if that would happen. I'm not
Gamescom
like that.
Gamescom this week, so we'll see what Sony announces.
Well, their event is in September, so,
okay.
You know.
I guess I'm going to wait until September.
I'm saying the existing Neo prior to E3 becomes the PlayStation Slim, and then they have an all-new Neo, which is, you know, comparable or 7 teraflops, trying to one-up the Scorpio. But it's funny because since Microsoft came out and announced theirs first, Sony has to respond, which then gives Microsoft the last word in this round, if you really think about it. You know, because now Sony has to respond to something. And when they come out and say something like, oh, we have 7 teraflops, and then all of a sudden Microsoft's like, well, we got 10. And ours, yeah. And yours is $600. Oh, ours is $399. You know, and, you know, Microsoft, and I heard this, I think, on one of IGN's podcasts with Ryan McCaffrey, Unlocked. I think it was in that show where they're just like, you know, hey, they're going to get the last word this time. They are setting themselves up, announcing stuff early. People think it was a bad idea, but when it comes down to the end in the long run, they're going to get the last word this time. And right. it's going to be interesting. It's going to be pretty fun.
Yep.
All right.
Good move. I think it was a very good move by Microsoft. And,
yep.
You know, honestly, if the 500 gig Xbox One S was available, I'd about that.
Yeah, me too.
I would have, because I still external. Got my external drive. I'm hooking up to it. But,
yeah.
This is the one available now. I wanted to get one, and the 2 terabytes is nice for when I travel. I can throw some stuff on there. But 500 gig is plenty enough to throw a game or two on there.
Yeah.
Oh, sure.
Several on there. So I really don't need it, and it would have saved some money. But, you know.
And the 500 is what you're used to with the original X.
Yeah,
Xbox One S.
It really is. And I'm glad that they're doing that and not forcing people to go back up to 400. You know, they're going to come out at that $299 and mm-hmm. and give you what, and it's a competitive. So it's going to be great. I think Microsoft is going to have a really good holiday season.
Yeah.
Depending on what the Neo is and what Sony does, I really think if they don't do anything, this could be a really good holiday season for Microsoft.
Yeah.
And next year, I think, is going to be great too with Scorpio.
And the other thing about they're going to keep the 2 terabyte around as the premium consoles, like your Gears of War 4 premium console. So they'll leave those for those. But I think the good thing about getting those sold and out of the way is so they can knock off that $399 price tag, like you're saying, Mark. Like, oh no, so say in September the PlayStation Neo comes out and they're like, oh, ours is $299 comparable. And unlike Microsoft's 2 terabyte $399 version, and Microsoft's like, well, we don't have a 2 terabyte $399 version. All we have is a terabyte and a 500, $299 and $349. You know what I mean? So like what you're saying, they need to get that out of there, and they need to get that price out of everybody's mind, pushed out to somewhere else to say, you know, well, no, we don't have a $399 console anymore unless it's a special edition. So,
yep.
Cool.
And I know with the podcast and Lock Guys we're talking too, I mean, yeah, like if Sony comes out and says this is what it is, I mean, Microsoft has the bank to put whatever price on it they want.
Right.
They could just suck it up and say, all right, we're going to give them away for $100. What are you going to do, Sony? I mean, Sony's broke as a company with the exception of the PlayStation division. So.
Yeah. I really wish that play. I really wish the PlayStation division could like break off. And you know, they could just be PlayStation. They don't have to be Sony yeah. PlayStation. They could just be PlayStation because really it's like, I'd hate to see like a lot of their stuff go to try to keep, you know, the TV, Sony TV division alive because really
they'll keep the PlayStation alive. It's too profitable for them.
No. I know that. I'm just saying, I was just like, I hate to see PlayStation's money going elsewhere. Can you imagine like if you have to push millions and billions of dollars into other places where you're just eating money and, you know, that allow like Microsoft has so much money, like what you're just saying, they have so much money in the bank. Like if PlayStation didn't have to keep the rest of Sony afloat, you know, they could do something just like that too. Can you imagine as a consumer, you know, like those two companies battling it out saying, okay, we're going to eat $1 billion. Well, we're going to eat $1 billion. All of a sudden our consoles are $99. You know, we benefit.
So, yeah, exactly.
But yeah, it would be pretty cool.
Yeah. All right. So, according to Xbox Wire, did I do that good?
Yeah.
Right. So, according to Xbox Wire, the Halo Wars 2 beta was very much a success. And that's from the standpoint of that the developers, which is 343, mm-hmm. They have taken the feedback and they're actually changing the game. And I think this is really what a beta is all about. It's not just, hey, let me play this game early before release. Mm-hmm. It's about giving feedback to the developers and trying to fix things and make things for the better. So they've taken all the feedback, and this beta was what, like right just after E3?
Yeah.
Is when I think it started.
Yep.
And so they started off and they call it a development beta, and they're going to be changing the game at 5 main areas, including the controls, leader abilities, bases, resources and energy, and population. And on their article that they have on Xbox Wire, they actually go into detail on each of those sections over there. And it's a nice little read. You might want to check it out. And at the end, they show that there's another beta that's coming out in early 2017. It's going to be both for Windows 10 and Xbox One. So in case you didn't know, I guess this game will be cross-platform on the two. And I would imagine it's going to be like the buy one, get it on both. Hopefully, maybe.
Yes, this is a play anywhere.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's pretty cool. It's nice to see that, you know, this beta went really, really good. And they're addressing even connectivity issues, which is something that, what, EA is king of? So they ran into that even a little bit.
Right.
Did you guys get to play the beta?
Yes, I played just a couple rounds, but... Yeah, it was pretty rough with connection issues that they mentioned in there, but yeah. It is good that people went out there. It did seem like they did get a lot of feedback out of it. So yeah, this is awesome. And it got delayed, so you know, this is good. Halo Wars was awesome.
Yeah.
So, you know, you don't need to cram another game this fall. Ooh, for sure. But yeah.
All right. And some more news on the Xbox front. Major Nelson earlier this past week announced it was an interesting little announcement that he had where Microsoft announced it and then immediately they posted up on YouTube the interview that Major Nelson had with the
12-year-old kid.
Yeah, the CEO of Beam. I guess Microsoft could not buy Twitch, so they bought Beam instead. Have you guys heard of Beam before?
Never heard of it.
I've heard of it. It's different. I mean, they try to take a little bit of a different approach. They really like it to be
interactive.
Yeah, it's interactive. Like, you know, I think at one point in time, Twitch was like, you could use the chat, like people are using the chat to play, like, not Pokemon, but some game or something like that that somebody was streaming. And then, you know, it Beam, I think, came out of that. So you can really, like, interact with the game, the gamer, to make decisions and stuff like that in there. But it's really cool because, you know, we're tech, we're all in the tech, you know, we're all in the IT field. Do you guys remember when Twitch was, like, really struggling to handle the bandwidth of all the people that were hitting it? And then all of a sudden, you know, Amazon is the one that purchased Twitch. Right. So, and I think at one time Google was even trying to get them, right? Is that what you were saying?
Yeah, there was a couple of companies trying to get them. A
couple of people were trying to get them. But when Amazon got it, it was awesome because they could fall back on AWS, which I think is what Twitch was already running on. But they just got this huge bandwidth spike. I think that's one thing that Beam is going to get from being purchased by Microsoft is they get to be on top of the probably the Azure service.
Right.
But they're not changing anything. Like, you're going to be able to do PC, PlayStation 4. Like, none of that's changing. It's just they're going to be the back-end infrastructure on it, which is which is pretty cool. Because Microsoft's, like, number two now. Amazon's still number one in the cloud service, but Azure really, like, kicked, like, Google Cloud. Cloud's rear end recently.
So they're really
climbing, but it's pretty cool. It's almost like, do we, since Microsoft owns Beam, do we have to go from Twitch to Beam and put our show on there now?
I would say probably that we shouldn't do that, because I'm guessing that Microsoft's probably going to shut down Beam by 2018.
I was another nice try.
Available on your Windows 10 mobile device.
Oh.
I got an email today about because I had a Windows 10 phone and Amazon sent me a thing. They're canceling their app. Everybody's canceling their Windows mobile apps.
All right.
Windows Phone is officially dead.
Yeah, it's dead. So
sad. It was a nice platform. I liked it.
Yeah.
But anyways,
yep. Was.
But. Yep.
A lot of stuff. Yep. Thankfully, the Xbox isn't there yet. All right. Then Rainbow Six Siege. You guys heard of that game?
Nope.
Love it.
Haven't played it in a long time, actually. It's been a really long time.
Oh. Well, I guess, Brun, you are not the norm. I guess we kind of knew that anyway.
Oh.
According to numbers provided to IGN by Ubisoft... should we believe it? It's IGN. Sure.
Yeah, go for it.
They're saying that daily player totals right now are higher than when the game first released 9 months ago. Huh. So that means what? The game came out in November-ish? Something like that?
I think so, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you know that when a game first comes out, it's usually the hotness at the moment. Everybody's all over it. And then there's a decline. But now it's 40% higher. And that's daily active users. So that's just some interesting metrics on that game.
I went in and played last week. Played some, I think, last weekend. And they have definitely made a lot of changes to that game. Some of the interfaces and different things. So they not only are they adding a new operators and a map here and there, the game does need more maps, I think. This one map every 3 months kind of stinks, but they've done some other changes to the game, which are kind of neat, and they continue to work on it.
Evolve it. Yep.
I can't believe I remember back before this game came out, I was telling Braun, you know, I remember we talked about how much love we had for Terrace Hunt. I was like, this game, I'm not paying $60 to play Terrace Hunt. Well, I did, and I've played probably hundreds of hours of it. Every time I go in and play, I have a blast. It's so much fun. I'm excited for, I'm glad to see this and more people getting on this game late, which is weird. You don't see this. Like you said, Rob, you see that burst at the top, and then it trails off. Uh-huh. This is having that opposite effect, which is what they wanted. They stayed from the beginning. They were building this as a more of a platform, and I guess it's working for them. That's good.
So. Yeah, and I mean, you really don't see. There's really few games that pop in my mind when I think about like post development support and post support like that. Like, yes, they're releasing their stuff for their season pass that they had, and but the games that I think of that come to mind are besides Siege is Battlefield 4. You know, it obviously struggled at the very beginning, and that stuff needed fixed. But even past that, they just keep pumping more and more into the game and more into the game. And they had a season pass, but even past their season pass, it was just like, here's more stuff, here's more stuff, here's more things for the community that's been with us for a long time. And they really, like, Battlefield 4 is the best Battlefield game out there that they've ever made. And the other one that comes to mind is Titanfall. Titanfall released and had very little in it. But when I came around to buy Titanfall, I had this just massive dump of content. I mean, the amount of stuff that's into the original Titanfall now than from when it released is insane, the amount of stuff that they put in that game. And I think a lot of that was free, wasn't it? Didn't they just put that stuff in for free? Like, what's the mode that you and I play a lot, Wing? Where it's...
I'm sorry, which game?
Titanfall.
Oh, yeah, it's like the Horde mode.
Yeah, like the Horde mode, but
I can't think of what.
Like, that wasn't even in the original game.
Frontier, right?
Frontier, yeah. Like that wasn't even in the original part of it, was it?
Oh, no. The Titanfall today is so much better than what it was at release.
Yeah, so
Hands down.
Titanfall and Siege, they, in my mind, they kind of come hand in hand, and Battlefield's another one of those. I mean, I guess you could put Destiny in there as well as far as post content and stuff, but they have sold all of their stuff, like, and to me, they've done it completely wrong. But it's really cool to see that. I know there's still a lot of, you know, like you said, there's a lot of people still playing it. It's pretty
Cassie
cool.
Well, Cassie Mouse made a comment that, you know, well, the game was free for a few days, but that's not what they're talking about. And they have a chart that they were provided by IGN where when the game first launched, it went up, you know, it had its immediate spike on day one. And then it sat there for a few months, and then it went up, I guess it's by week. So by Christmas time, it got up there where, you know, kind of it increased even more over the original. Then their first DLC came out, and it stayed pretty relatively at that number until... Then it looks like it kind of dropped off in February when Dustline came out, the second DLC, it spiked. But it stayed up until Skull Rain came out, the third DLC just came out. That number was higher than it was previously. And now with Skull Rain, it's at its highest it ever has been. So they are seeing, again, even if you go back and not, you know, you're not counting the free days, this game is still... They've got a lot more people playing. And this is after they've started implementing their anti-cheat and are banning people. And they're doing, these guys are doing permabans as well. So permanent banning seems to be the thing. Overwatch is doing it. Siege is doing it. There was another game that's doing it. I forgot who it was. But that's pretty much the wave of the future. They're going to permanently ban. So even with all the cheaters getting kicked, we got more people. And I think that helps. People will want to play when they know the cheaters aren't there anymore. So this is all good.
Yeah. I heard somebody in our chat right now, Raging Rhino. I heard he's kind of okay at Rainbow Six Siege. So just hearsay that he's kind of good at the game. But, all right. What's up? What's next?
All right. Gears of War 4. Might have heard of that game as well.
Just pre-ordered it.
Nice. If you pre-ordered it,
You're
going to get some new bonuses. But wait, there's more.
But wait.
No. So they just detailed the Brothers to the End Elite Gear Pack. That's a new pre-order bonus for all editions of Gears of War 4. It's going to have, so it plays homage to some of the most beloved characters of Gears of War and new and current Gears of War 4 pre-order customers are going to receive three different characters. There's going to be Tomorrow Anya. Her appearance is based on her look in the Gears of War 4 television commercial Tomorrow, where she was introduced as the mother of J.D. Phoenix. Then there's Old Man Marcus, features an older Marcus Phoenix, as unveiled in the E3 2016 media briefing. And there's Zombie Dom.
That's hilarious.
It says, it proves that there's no keeping a good soldier down.
Yeah, that's pretty funny.
And then the Elite Gear Pack also includes the Gold Wave Lancer and Gold Wave Nasher, which are updated versions of the gold weapon skins awarded to the series' most dedicated day one players. Yep. Then... Also, lastly, all pre-order customers are going to be receiving Xbox 360 Gears of War Collection for use on their Xbox One. That includes all four previous games, Gears of War, Gears of War 2, Gears of War 3, and Gears of War Judgment.
Which they've given away. So basically
gives you three good games.
Yeah, they've given them away like 15 times by now. Like, everybody should already have them.
But still.
Oh, no.
If you've never played a Gears game, and you bought yourself an Xbox One, you want to play Gears of War?
Oh, yeah.
So for $60, you're getting five games, four of which are amazing.
Good.
I'm calling Gears of War 4 amazing. Judgment sucked. But
yeah,
still, I mean, you know, that it's insane. You're getting five amazing games.
That's like $12 a game.
So, yeah, that's incredible.
Yeah, so look
at your Xbox One. That's the thing. This is the 360 Gears collection to play on your Xbox One. So
yeah,
all these games are, that's awesome. Yeah. All did, you know, so again, you digitally order it, you're getting the digital games, they're all available.
Yep.
Love it.
Yeah, I have somebody at work that's never played any of them.
There you go. So, you need to point them to this story, man.
Yep. Oh, will do. I'll let him know tomorrow. You know, the one thing about Gears that I was a little disappointed in, because it's Coalition and it's an Xbox or it's a Microsoft owned studio now, correct? So
yes,
for $99 you have the ultimate, like the ultimate edition, which is basically the game and the season pass. I'm a little bummed. I was kind of hoping that they would have followed the path of Halo and not have had a season pass, but, you know, figured out a way to do something to give all the DLC and all the content out for free. I know I don't want to be, it's not like I'm not going to go, I won't buy the season pass. I didn't get it right away. But it's not like I'm not going to get it. It's just, I'm looking, you know, EA is always like a season pass, season pass, season pass. I mean, they've already come out, EA's already come out, and Titanfall, all the DLC for Titanfall is going to be free. And when you pre-order Battlefield 1, there is no mention of a season pass right now. And typically for Battlefield 1, they really push that season pass right when you pre-order. You know, hey, for, you know, get this edition, you get the season pass. Like, I think EA on Battlefield 1 may be giving out all the DLC for free or finding a way to kind of monetize a part of it. Similar to like Halo. And I saw this season pass. I'm like, oh man, it's kind of a bummer. I was kind of hoping they would find a different way around it. Cause I really think season passes are, it's like discouraged now. Like it's something people don't want to see. Like they don't want to buy a game and then immediately have to say, oh, well, I guess in 3 months I'm going to have to put more money down on this game or else I'm not going to play it. But yeah, there is a $99 version to get the season pass. So. Kind of a bummer, but well, I'm not asking. I'm not going to ask for free stuff. I know this stuff costs money, you know, and I don't want to. I just think it's like, remember, there were no such things as season passes for a while. It's like, oh, you can buy DLC. And then all of a sudden it was like, here's all the DLC you can get for 50 more bucks. And it's just like, well, you know, so now you want $120 from me now. instead of just 60. So I'd rather pay $20 more and get all the content, you know, all the time. You know, but
yeah, like I pre-ordered 4 things this week. I pre-ordered XCOM 2, and I bought the digital or deluxe version. Mm-hmm. So it has all the DLC that was available, but it's not like a season pass. But
right.
In a way, I guess it is but you know, there's only like, I think there was just 2 DLC packs for XCOM 2. So that's all you're getting. Forza Horizon 3. Could have bought the $100 that includes, but I bought the $80 version, the deluxe version, because it gets the VIP and stuff like that. But what the only difference between that and the $100 was that the extra $20 gets you like all the car packs. But like, there's so many cars in the game anyway. I never use them all. Yeah, it's just like I never buy those extra car packs.
Right.
Because there's usually just a couple cars I like, and that's all I play, and they're usually included. But
yeah, because I think we talked about this. Man, probably about a year ago, whenever Forza 2 came out, where we just drive around in the same car.
Right. Yeah, I remember that, actually.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, with Titanfall and Battlefield 1, I'm buying the $80 version of those. It's just some extra stuff that you get in the game, but it's nothing, it's not like including any DLC or anything. Usually, for the last 3 or 4 Battlefields, it's been season passes, and there is no mention of the season pass right now, so I'm really thinking they're kind of shying away from that, and I think that's good as far as.
Well, isn't Battlefield, don't they still offer their premium, isn't that what they basically call their season pass now? You have premium.
Yeah, and there's no that's not in Battlefield 1. Like when I was looking up to pre-order them, I did not see a Battlefield 1 premium. Because it'd be like $120 or $110 or something like that.
Yeah. Well, see, Brian, I don't blame you for not getting the season pass for Gears, because chances are, like for me, I don't do Gears multiplayer. It's horrible. I never enjoyed it. I love the campaign. I love Horde mode. So if the season pass is going to be nothing but multiplayer stuff, I wouldn't want it anyway.
Yeah. See, that's why I'm holding off. I'm the same way.
Right. Let's find out what's going to be in there before purchasing.
Yep. Cool.
All right. So I'll look for Gears of War 4 on October 11th, which is release date. And then lastly, Just Cause 3 has its final DLC. This came out on August 11th for people that have the Air, Land, and Sea season or expansion pass. And for everybody else, it'll be out on August 18th, which is Thursday, August 18th, and standalone, it costs $6 US. The expansion is the Bavarium Sea Heist, as you braving the waters of West Medici in your new heavily armored rocket boat.
Rocket boat. The rocket boat is awesome. Yeah. I love it.
It says you'll be infiltrating Stingray, a research facility holding the strongest weapon ever created by the Eden Corporation. And the other expansions. No, I think that's it for this one.
Yeah, that's all. That's the last one. The other two already came out.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, Just Cause 3.
So before we end round table here, I got a couple questions for you.
Okay, sure. Let me just preface this, guys. We got 30 minutes.
Gotcha. Yeah, this will be quick.
A couple of voicemails and emails.
So yep, this will be quick. Well. All right. So, and I want to ask this because this is our 400th episode, and you know, between episode 450 and 500, we're going to be, you know, possibly into another console, you know, the Scorpio will be out and things like that. I have 2 questions. What are you looking forward to for the rest of the year? And what are you looking forward to possibly in our next 50 to 100 episodes? Where are we going to be 100 episodes, 50 to 100 episodes from now? What do you guys think? Let's do a little bit of a prediction. Like for me, like this year, like I'm looking forward to October this year. It's Gears, and then the next week it's Battlefield 1, and then the next week it's Titanfall. You know, I'm looking forward to October, November. I can't wait to play those games. I'm really excited about that. But like, you know, where do I see us? Where do I see us in 100 episodes? You know, besides still doing the show, you know, not, you know, wanting to murder Rob or replacing Rob like Mark and I have talked about. I mean, you know, like us still being around, but, you know, Mark's going to be getting his, you know, be getting a Scorpio. He's going to be talking about a Scorpio. We'll finally send the Xbox One S that we were supposed to give away to Christoph to Christoph. But like me, myself, I don't see myself with a Scorpio, but I see myself playing all my Xbox games on my PC, you know, and that's where I want to see the Xbox go. But my thing is will Xbox still be, you know, obviously Xbox will still be around. They've announced the Scorpio, but you know, on episode 500, which is 2 years away, how will a Scorpio be doing? What do you guys, do you think we'll be, you know, back into a console war and we'll be number one, or will Sony come out and say, you know, 50,000 teraflops for, you know, for $199 and they buy another warehouse and buy 40 million of them themselves, or, you know, what do you got? What do you got for the net rest of the year? What are you guys looking forward to first?
Here, I'll start off.
Okay.
So I'm looking forward to a whole bunch of the titles that are out later on this year. For me, it seems like there's more titles this year that are interesting. That's something that I would like to play more so than the previous couple of years, because there's a whole bunch of really cool titles coming out. Probably, well, I'll say like within the next 3 to 4 months, including the Forza Horizon 3, which in itself is just hours and hours of gameplay. And then we've got, Dishonored 2? I know that one's kind of a niche game.
Oh, yeah.
Not everybody's really into that, but I loved the original Dishonored.
I forgot about that one.
So I'm really looking forward to that. Like you guys just talked about, there's Titanfall 2. I didn't really get into the original one all that much. I sort of regret a little bit not really playing it while everybody was playing it. I sort of got interested in it a little bit while it died down a little bit. So I'm hoping to jump on that one earlier. And then there's the, what was it? We just talked about it. Gears of War.
Yeah.
I can't remember something from like 5 minutes ago. Gears of War is coming out. Battlefield 1. What else? There was something, wasn't there another one?
There's a lot of stuff coming.
The zombie game where you put all that stuff together. Isn't that coming out this fall or this winter?
State of Decay?
No. Dead Rising.
Oh, Dead Rising. Oh, yeah, Dead Rising 4 will be out the January or December.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Don't forget the Dead Rising triple pack, which I pre-ordered the other day.
Okay.
Dead Rising 1, 2, and
oh, wow.
Dead Rising 2 Off the Record, I think it's called.
So Rob, what about 100 between, you know, a couple 100 episodes from now? Episode 500. Besides what Jesus Walks a Lot says, well, guys, we'll be this PlayStation life.
We'll be.
So. Actually, realistically, I think the only thing that'll change is we'll be a lot grayer.
Oh, okay.
We'll still be talking about the same stuff.
Yeah,
but
my hairline's going to recede even further than it already has in the first 400 episodes.
Go halfway down your back. Flip around. Go all the way down your back. I'm really curious to see what happens with VR and 4K.
Oh, okay.
VR. There was a lot of talk about VR initially, and I really don't hear much of anything anymore. Do you guys?
No, people were finally realizing what it really is going to be. Womp, 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 womp.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of money and, yeah.
Yeah.
You're freaked out every time someone walks in your room because you can't see them.
There
people
will
are gonna get injured, dude. There's gonna be some serious injuries.
There will be good. You know what? By time episode 500 comes out, Rob, I will say that VR will probably have a little bit of a foothold, because I think it's going to be until that point in time when there's actually going to be a good VR game. You know, and it's it, Vive and Oculus, you know, they have their things. And right now you see a lot of space games, a lot of racing games. I think those are the games that actually benefit from VR. Right. But then on, you know, on Sony's hand, you know, they're saying they're gonna have 50, 60 games this fall just for their PlayStation VR. And all I can think of is like, well, that's going to be like WiiWare. You know, it's going to be like Wii games and stuff like that. And I don't think that's good. I don't think that's going to be a good thing for VR as a whole. You know, and it won't be until the Scorpio comes out when we realize something out there. Like, will Fallout 4 be the best VR game that hits a console because it's on Vive and Scorpio will have Vive on it and things like that? But yeah, it's a good point. Like, where will we be? I think VR will probably have something out there, but I think it's going to take that killer game. And everything I've seen so far isn't going to do it. So,
yeah. And then, you know, with 4K, I know that things are progressing in that direction, but what's the adoption rate going to be? Because about a week ago, I was looking at 4K monitors and I was kind of like, you know, I've got like this 3-inch area on one of my monitors. I've got dual monitor PC monitors that I play Xbox on. And one of my monitors has a whole bunch of dead pixels in a region. I'm like, I wonder if I can replace it with a 4K monitor. Those things aren't cheap.
No, they're not cheap, and they're not very fast refresh rate when it comes to that. I mean, I'm still with a 1080, you know, with 100, at least 140, you know, 1440. You know, 100 megahertz IPS monitor, I think, is better than a 4K one right now. But
yeah. So, you know, what's the adoption rate going to be just because TVs are so cheap now? Mm-hmm. You know, are people really going to want to spend a lot more money for not necessarily that bigger of a screen, possibly even a smaller screen just to get the 4K?
Yeah.
But, I mean, the stuff does look really nice, and we're getting more and more content. So, you know, hopefully it'll be adopted much better than something like the 3D TVs got adopted, which was more of a fad.
Right.
But yeah, I'm curious to see where all that winds up, just because the, you know, Sony and Microsoft consoles are kind of betting on that. And I know that, you know, we need to go in that direction because, I mean, you can buy a $100 Roku now that does 4K. So hopefully the new systems won't be that expensive.
Right.
And I'm very optimistic about where things are going in terms of hardware. And I think the landscape is going to change a little bit. We probably don't know exactly where it's going to yet, but Microsoft, I think, is pushing us in that direction a little bit, or instead of everything being the same, which it's been for years, like you have the consoles and everything like that. Microsoft is pushing the envelope again with this Play Anywhere stuff, and then, you know, the cross system, and it's going to be interesting. A lot of unknowns.
Yep. Mark, rest of the year.
I'm looking for a lot forward to a lot of games coming out, but stuff you guys have already mentioned. What I'm looking forward to next year, Crackdown 3, Mass Effect 4, Mass Effect Andromeda. Those are the high ones on mine. As for the show, I want to see our community continue to grow. I want to find new ways that we can grow our community, have a larger audience for the live shows, see what we can do, you know, going forward, man. I want to get us out there to a larger audience somehow, some way, and just keep it fun. I just want us to keep having fun and enjoy doing this and make it fun for our listeners. So
cool.
That's what I look forward to. And world domination.
All right. World
bumping domain. Major Nelson off as the top Xbox podcast. That would be nice.
So. Hey, Armistice RJ donated $10. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
He said that the other 390 is on its way to total 400.
Sweet. Awesome.
love it.
Well, then we can get that Xbox One S to Christoph.
Oh, yeah. There.
I'll be opening that one.
So, all right.
All right.
Community time, right, Rob?
Yep. Yes, sir. All right. Are we doing Friday Night Life this week?
I would like to again. I would like to do Overwatch again. I do know that I have a very long trip for some football games, so I might not be back till later if Mark wants to hop on and do some more Overwatch.
I think I can. Okay. So again, I'm Pacific time, so look for me probably about 8 p.m.
Yeah.
But it depends. I got my father-in-law's here, so
yep.
I'm not sure exactly what day he's leaving.
Yeah. I mean, I even did some Rocket League with Brentley as well. I mean, that was pretty fun. But I had a lot of fun this week, and I like to do it again.
Soon. Overwatch, man. It's fun.
Yeah. So anybody has Overwatch or you know, whatever, then pop out there, or message again in the Facebook group. We'll get together. So. Yeah.
All right. So if you'd like to know exactly how you can communicate with the Xbox Life, I'll answer your question right now. You can go to thesxboxlife.com and send us a voicemail. You can record your voicemail right on our webpage using any mobile device, supposedly, so they say, or a PC and such through your web browser. And we will use, if it's appropriate, we will use your recording on the show. And we get
if you say something inappropriate, like Rob is your favorite host, we refuse to use that.
Yeah, I've already deleted like 500 of those.
Fox. He's my favorite. We've got a couple, actually for this show, don't we?
Yeah, we got a couple.
Yeah. Yeah, so I personally love hearing people's voices as they ask us questions. And, you know, don't be afraid. You can do it. It just takes a couple seconds. Also, you can send us an email at contact@thisxboxlife.com, as well as going to our website and hitting the contact page where you can send us.
Are we going to hear the voicemails?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah. We're going
to
hear.
Yeah. You get to hear them through our This Xbox Life transcription service, namely me. Or you get what?
I just thought he was going to play him when he was talking about it. Now he's moved on to the emails. It's like, well, we got two voicemails to play.
Oh.
I thought we were going to hear him now. So
no, I thought he was going through everything and then we were going to play him. But
oh, okay.
Yeah, that's what I was going to do.
Okay.
All right.
I was just going to mention.
Rob, I'm sorry.
The thing, and then we go through it. I know you're new to this.
I've only done this 400 episodes. I still don't know what I'm doing.
I know, right? Yeah, so anyway, you can leave us a voicemail where we'll play your message on the podcast, or you can send us an email or go through our webpage to send us a message, and then you can hear them read through our Vin Diesel transcription service. So should I keep going?
No, let's play it.
Twitter.
Okay. Twitter.com/Xbox Life.
Yeah.
All right.
So we got a couple voicemails.
All right. First one is Jean-Paul, right?
Good morning, gentlemen. A bit of a moan this week. I'm not a member of the preview program because I want stability in my Xbox system because I have a wife. It doesn't understand the ins and outs of technology, let's say, and the quirks that people who are a little bit deeper into the subject will accept when things don't work. In the new Cortana update, I know you can switch Cortana off and go back to the Xbox control vocally, which is wonderful, but I thought I'd try the new Cortana system because you can check the web and stuff like that. It just doesn't work. You ask to switch on, switch off, go to sleep. It says it hasn't got the bandwidth. This is a lie. And then you have to ask it several times, and eventually it will then tell you what you want to know. Dear Microsoft, please do not release software that does not work 90% of the time. We all realize that stuff doesn't work sometimes, and that's life. But You guys were talking about Alexandra, I believe, on the Amazon. Fantastic product. Google Voice, also a fantastic product. Cortana, I'm afraid to say, very lacking, very disappointing, and I wish Microsoft would really start to get their system operational. Anyway, show guys, and I wish you happy gaming the next week.
All right. So Wing, did you pay him to put this in there? Because it sounded exactly like a lot of the things you were saying for that stuff.
No comment.
No comment.
Plead the fifth.
Hey, Wing, you've really mastered the British accent.
Yes, we agree with you on that, and we've, you know, discussed that, you know, numerous times. But yeah, it seems like they really dropped the ball on that. But it is good that you can turn it off, and I've shut mine off, and I'm very happy with just keeping the Xbox commands.
I can say this: my S will not be in the preview program.
Yeah,
but I'm actually going to keep my other one on it. Not that I'll use it much, but I can check out some features.
You want to annoy the kids?
I can report back to you. If it doesn't work, I won't care because it won't be my main console.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So I will keep that one on the preview program, but my S will not be going on it. So. All right.
All right, and our next one is Dark Eye Defender. Jacob, you guys remember Dark Eye Defender? Yeah. Been with us forever.
That's like a fellow brother, man.
Yeah. Woo! It's like him and I think Jesus was just putting in there. He's like, it's been 5 years since I started listening to you guys. So said time flies. And yes, it absolutely does. So, but here's Jacob.
Remember that scene?
Hey guys, Dark Eye Defender here, coming in with the old intro. Hopefully the audio wasn't too bad. I hope you guys are enjoying recording the episode 400. Pretty big. Sorry I can't be there. I've adopted Democulus' sleep schedule, so you know how that is. Hope you guys have a great more shows. I miss gaming with you guys. Hopefully I can get back in there again. Hopefully soon. Mark, hopefully you're enjoying that Xbox One S. Hope to get mine in October when the Gears of War 1 comes out. All right, guys. Miss you guys. It's been everyone's favorite Dark Eye Defender. Right, bye.
All right.
Dude, I can't help but smile. I miss that guy. I haven't talked to him in so long. Yeah,
it's been a long time.
He's just gone like MIA, but now I guess, yeah, he's got that work schedule and, you know, his off schedule from mine. So,
yeah.
But Jacob, yes, if you ever see me on, hit me up. Let's get in a party and play. So it's been way too long. And I'm so glad. I figured he'd long gone. I'm so happy to know he's still around listening.
Yep, yep. And he played awesome. Quiet Hand. That was our intro music.
Times After Dusk, right?
Yep. Times After Dusk. Yep.
Yep. So I'm waiting for their second album, by the way, so you need to put word out to those guys.
Oh, yeah. I'll talk to him tomorrow. People that don't know, because we haven't used that in a very long time, the guy that was singing in that song, I work with him. So, but yeah, very cool
song.
So
when the Google algorithm yanks us off of YouTube for copyright, is he going to help us out?
he said it was okay for us to use his song, so we're in the clear.
Yeah, we had
permission.
Good.
Yep. From the writer and singer himself. So.
Yeah.
All right,
explain
guys,
that to the algorithm.
Minutes. 10 minutes.
Got a heartbreak in 10 minutes. So,
all right.
So we got an email this week from Juan. Hello, longtime listener and member of the group. Had a question that I thought would be a great topic on your podcast, and I would love to get your thoughts. I noticed Xbox One doesn't have a first party release in November. I also found that Xbox is having their 15-year anniversary this year in November. I think Microsoft is planning something huge this November. What do you guys think Microsoft could do for its fans this November? They just can't leave this month empty, right? What do you guys think?
Well, with the October that they're having,
Yeah.
Gears and Battlefield and Titanfall, which two of the three are
first party.
Yeah, well, yeah, two of the three are
first party. So they've only got Forza Horizon 3 coming out in September and Gears in October. So and that's it. That's first party games. So but I think what is it coming? It's coming Gears is coming out with a 27th of October. It's like the end of October
11th.
So
yeah.
Was it October 11th?
Thought so.
Yeah, Gears is early October. It's the first game in October.
So I don't think it has to be in November. I mean, they're putting out a game. It's holiday time. Call of Duty is probably going to dominate November. You know, it typically does. Gears is going to get out there ahead of time.
Titanfall is the last week of October. Titanfall is
coming out. You know, again, that's not Xbox specific this time, but. Titanfall 1 was, and I think they're going to see a huge surge. I'm going to be all over Titanfall, man. So, but I don't think it really matters. What I would love to see in November, to be honest, for their 15-year anniversary, I'd love to see them offer an Xbox Live Platinum and say, now you can digitally rent games, you know. I'd pay more, $100 a year instead of $50 or whatever. I'd pay more every year just to have the ability to just like download a game and play it, and have a couple that you don't buy, but you can play them. Mm-hmm. And then when you're done with them, you just delete them, and then you can download something new. Something like that would be really cool to see, like a digital rental service type of thing. Yep. I'd like to see them say come out on the 15th anniversary and say, oh, by the way, we're now going to release original Xbox games on the Xbox platform, free backward compatibility for those, and the ability to purchase them. I think that would be awesome. So, because I'd buy some stuff, you know, whether it looks bad or not, I'd buy it.
But. I mean, Gamescom is this week, so maybe they'll say something there. And then the one thing we're talking about is like No Man's Sky. Like, if it is coming out to Xbox One, boy, wouldn't that be interesting for November? You know?
Yeah. We also know that the clubs and stuff are coming. Yep. I'm expecting that this year.
Yeah, me too.
So maybe around the 15th anniversary, hey, you know, we're going to have a TXL club now on Xbox Live, and I think that'd be cool.
Yep. So. All right. Thanks for the question.
Yes.
So. Okay. All right. We just covered this a little bit ago, but you can also find us on Twitter at This Xbox Life. And also we have a very active Facebook group. Just search for This Xbox Life on Facebook. And it is a closed group, so you have to ask to be let in. And we have no problems letting people in, but that keeps people from outside the group from seeing your posts all the time. So you don't get your friends and family don't get annoyed by all your gaming posts like they do your Candy Crush requests.
Yep.
Also, that's about it for this week's retail releases. There's a whole bunch of stuff for the Xbox One. I'll rattle through the list here real quick. We've got Valentino Rossi, the game, Uno, Prominence Poker, Hitman Episode 4, Bangkok, Grow Up. I'm not telling you that. I'm saying that's the game. Then Baila Latino, Unnamed Fiasco, and lastly F1 2016. Xbox 360 does not have anything. And as it's beginning to be the middle of the month here, we do have a change in Games with Gold. Tombstone is going to be out on the 16th, Tumblestone is going to be out on the 15th, and it's going to be replaced by WWE 2K16. And Warriors Orochi's 3 Ultimate is going to be for the 2 more weeks. And on Xbox 360, Spelunky is being replaced by Beyond Good and Evil. Then lastly, if you make any purchases on Amazon, make sure to use our affiliate link. That helps us out by giving us a little finder's fee for sending you their way. You can find our affiliate link on our website by clicking through the Amazon logo. Please do that each and every time, because that only lasts a day or up until your next purchase. So please go through there each and every time you make your purchase on Amazon. If you're on iTunes, Give us a 5-star review. That really helps us out by helping us become a featured podcast on the iTunes store. And so I believe that's all that we've got here for episode 400. Did you guys want to add any closing words?
Yeah, let's make this like 30 seconds. I just want to say thanks to everybody that has supported us. 400 episodes is a really long time to listen. I'm shocked. You know, I mean, like Jesus said, he's been listening to us for 5 years. Jacob was one of the originals, and he's still listening. It's great. If you haven't, we haven't spoken in a long time, reach out, join us in a party, say hi, because I miss a lot of you people. But for myself personally, we do this because we enjoy it, and it's because of you guys coming out and letting us know that you're listening and having fun. So thank you. I've had a fun time. I can't believe we've gone this long.
Yep. You said everything I was going to say. So yeah, I really, really, really appreciate it. It's awesome. It's fun to have, you know, this long. So,
you know, I wanted to add one thing, and that's that, you know, when we started this, man, so many years ago, back in 2008, you know, when we were initially talking about, you know, starting up the podcast and, you know, switching off of the other podcast that you guys did, you know, it was to go into this with the intention of just doing a podcast, talking about the news, talking about gaming and things that we love. And one thing that was kind of an unforeseen benefit of all of this is just, you know, building friendships. And normally you don't think about that when you're like a media producer of sorts. You know, you just focus in on the content. But, you know, not only are we walking away with the experience of, you know, doing the weekly show and such, but, you know, we've grown a community that have come together because of us. And, you know, it's not just us that have done that. It's everybody. It's everybody spreading the word, telling your friends about it and getting them to come in and be part of, you know, our Xbox Life family. And, you know, I think that we're really, you know, blessed to have everybody in there. And, you know, it's awesome to have everybody, you know, maybe friends for life. That's so cool.
1 minute.
Yeah. Yep. Got 1 minute left.
Okay. So, all right. So, everybody, go ahead. Go ahead, Rob.
No, that's it. I was going to say, I'll just close out.
All right.
This is Rob Olson as Pre-Star. Thanks for listening, everybody. See you for the next 400 shows, hopefully.
Yep. I'm Brun BJ Swick 33. Everybody, have a good one.
And I'm Mark, aka Wingman 709, taking off.
Woohoo!